When the president offered me this nomination, I was deeply honored. But it was not a position I had sought out and I thought carefully before accepting. The confirmation process and the work of serving on the court, if confirmed, requires sacrifices, particularly from my family. I chose to accept the nomination because I believe deeply in the rule of law and the place of the Supreme Court in our nation. I believe Americans of all backgrounds deserve an independent Supreme Court that interprets our Constitution and laws as they are written. And I believe I can serve my country by playing that role. I come before this committee with humility about the responsibility that I have been asked to undertake, and with appreciation for those who have come before me. I was 9 years old when Sandra Day O'Connor became the first woman to sit in this seat. She was a model of grace and dignity throughout her distinguished tenure on the court. When I was 21 years old and just beginning my career, Ruth Bader Ginsburg sat in this seat. She told the committee, "What has become of me could only happen in America." I have been nominated to fill Justice Ginsburg's seat, but no one will ever take her place. I will be forever grateful for the path she marked and the life she led. If confirmed, it would be the honor of a lifetime to serve alongside the Chief Justice and 7 Associate Justices. I admire them all and would consider each a valued colleague. And I might bring a few new perspectives to the bench. As the President noted when he announced my nomination, I would be the first mother of school-aged children to serve on the court. And I know that it would make Senators Young and Braun happy to know that I would be the first justice to join the court from the 7th Circuit in 45 years. I would be the only sitting justice who didn't attend school at Harvard or Yale, but I am confident that Notre Dame could hold its own, and maybe I could even teach them a thing or two about football.
You and I both know that judges should not be policymakers, but could it be that one of the reasons these confirmation hearings have become so contentious is because some Americans have given up on the idea of fair and impartial judges who do not pick winners and losers? That they've given up on an independent judiciary? I hope not. Judges should not be unelected super legislators, giving their political allies wins they could not secure through the rough and tumble of the political process. Our founders, through the Constitution, provided that judges would be independent of political pressure. Chief Justice Roberts reminded all of us recently that we do not have Obama judges or Trump judges, Bush judges, or Clinton judges. And ideally, that is true. You've said judges constrain themselves by making a choice to follow the law where it leads, trying to check their own preferences at every turn. In the end, a judge's internal compass, her commitment to the rule of law, rather, is the most important constraint upon any sort of judicial willfulness. But you're being asked to abandon that, Judge. You stand accused of intending to violate your oath before you even take it. Further, our Democratic colleagues want you to guarantee a result in a case as a quid pro quo for your confirmation. It's outrageous.
Let's be very honest about this. This president has never suffered an unuttered thought. He gives us 25 tweets a day to tell us what's going through that fertile mind. We know what he thinks because he tells us what he thinks. And he made it clear that he wants his Supreme Court and this nominee to join him in eliminating the Affordable Care Act. This is his litmus test. How many times have we heard it? How many times have we heard his criticism of Chief Justice Roberts for failing to strike down Obamacare? When he was running for president, then-candidate Trump tweeted, quote, "If I win the presidency, my judicial appointments will do the right thing, unlike Bush's appointee John Roberts on Obamacare."
The American people need to have help to make rent or their mortgage payment. We should provide financial assistance to those who have lost their job and help parents put food on the table. Small businesses need help, as do the cities, towns, and hospitals that this crisis has pushed to the brink. The House bill would help families and small businesses get through this crisis. But Senate Republicans have not lifted a finger for 150 days, which is how long that bill has been here in the Senate, to move the bill. Yet, this committee is determined to rush a Supreme Court confirmation hearing through in just 16 days. Senate Republicans have made it crystal clear that rushing a Supreme Court nomination is more important than helping and supporting the American people who are suffering from a deadly pandemic and a devastating economic crisis. Their priorities are not the American people's priorities. But for the moment, Senate Republicans hold a majority in the Senate and determine the schedule. So here we are.
To the women of America, we have come so far, and in the name of RBG, we should not go backwards. As the rabbi said at Justice Ginsburg's memorial in the Capitol, her dissents, her strong words when she would disagree with the Republican-appointed justices, her words were never cries of defeat. They were blueprints for the future. So to all Americans, this hearing, whatever these guys try to do, whatever you hear from me, it will not be a cry of defeat. It will instead be our blueprint for the future. Yes, Judge. I think this hearing is a sham. I think it shows real messed up priorities from the Republican Party. But I am here to do my job, to tell the truth. To all Americans, we don't have some clever procedural way to stop this sham, to stop them from rushing through a nominee, but we have a secret weapon that they don't have. We have Americans who are watching, who work hard every day, believe in our country and the rule of law, whether they are Democrats, Republicans, or independent. They know what this president and the Republican Party are doing right now is very wrong. In fact, 74% of Americans think we should be working on a COVID relief package right now instead of this.
This question of what happens when there's a Supreme Court vacancy during a presidential election year, 2020 is not the first time America has faced that question. Indeed, in our country's history, that question has come up a total of 29 times. So 29 times, presidents have faced the same circumstance, and presidents have nominated individuals to fill those positions all 29 times, 100% of it. Doesn't matter if you're a Democrat or Republican. From a president's perspective, it's easy. If there's a vacancy, even during a presidential election year, you make a nomination. 44 individuals have served as president throughout the history of our country. Half of them, 22 of the presidents we have made Supreme Court nominations for vacancies that occurred during a presidential election year. But what has the Senate done? Well, again, the Senate precedent is quite clear, and is something that our Democratic friends do not want to address, do not want to confront. Of those 29 times, 19 of them occurred when the president and the Senate were of the same party. And when the president and the Senate are the same party, history shows that those nominees get confirmed. 17 of those 19 were confirmed for vacancies that occurred during a presidential election year. On the other hand, for those doing math at home, the remaining 10 occurred when the Senate and the president were of different parties. When the president and senator of different parties, the Senate over history has confirmed only 2 of those 10 nominees. Again, history is clear. The overwhelming majority of instances that the president and Senate are of different parties, that nominee doesn't get confirmed. That is, of course, what happened with Judge Garland, nominated by President Obama. President Obama was a Democrat, the Senate was in Republican hands, and following tradition of 200 years, the Senate did not confirm that nominee.